So yeah, I was just studying a bit access control, Linux access control, and stuff like that. And for example, like PolicyKit and the DBus access controls. And then I basically got a little bit familiar with the concept of PolicyKit and DBus access control. And then I started looking at some of the components, I guess, that actually use DBus and PolicyKit. And then I noticed about how systemd actually implements the PolicyKit as well as DBus, but systemd actually implements DBus in a way that you can actually use it as an access control mechanism to manage systemd from a service perspective. So what that basically means is that we now have three access controls, one of which is PolicyKit, which is actually nice because, well, if an application implemented in a particular way, then you might actually be able to run privileged actions as an unprivileged user. So in the case of systemd, I was actually just checking out a little bit with the PK action to see what kind of stuff systemd uses. So I'll just grab systemd. And then the first thing I actually noticed was the bus access. And since I was also at that point, sorry, at that point actually studying a little bit about DBus access control, that basically just got my attention that right there. So basically what it says here is the DBus access. I can actually look it up if you actually go into, I think it's probably a user share polkit. Well, yeah, or maybe even etc polkit. Let's just have a look. ls user share polkit 1, and then you have rules d. Oh, I can't actually access it as an unprivileged user, so I'll just go to root to check that out. I have some root. No, I'll just do this. And that doesn't look like much useful. Actions, let's see if the actions. Yeah, the I think the. No, actually. Actions. These are actually old style. Old style PolicyKit local authority files. But I see that the systemd PolicyKit policy is actually written old style. So yeah, that probably be converted. I think these files should probably be converted to new style, I guess, if I understand this stuff correctly. Anyway, so let's just get the let's have a look at what's in the systemd thingy. And it's pretty simple. Basically what it's saying is that and we're looking at the bus access. We well, let's ignore this block here, but this is the reply password. Basically what it's saying here is, and this works with basically actions and subjects and results. Actually, this is actually something that doesn't quite. Makes sense to me. Why is there's like different ways to write policy, and I guess this is because this is actually policy, but this isn't the PKLA format, and it damn sure ain't the JavaScript format. This is just plain XML, just like DBus uses XML. So that's kind of weird. But anyways, what it's saying here is the action ID is this address, and then the bus action bus access object, I guess. And then the description is privilege system and service manager access. So actually, if you have access to this here, to this action ID, then from a policy kit's perspective, or from a from a policy kit perspective, you'll have access to manage the system and service manager. And that basically means you can run the system control app to do all kinds of management tasks. So then it has a message here: authentication is required to access the system and service bus manager. So it actually wants wants to authenticate you. Anyways, so what it says is allow any no, allow inactive no, so basically only active users that are part of the admin group can actually do this. So I am here, for example, Dominic here, I'm actually Dominic here, ID. So I should, from a policy kit perspective, should be able to run stuff. And this is actually a bad example because I've been already been tinkering with Dominic. So, but anyways, from a policy perspective, I should be able to run system control and do all kinds of stuff. So that's actually a policy kit clearance that I already have. But there's a more access control, because if I actually, with this clearance, if I actually do something, then I still get access denied, because then we'll hit the DBus access control. Now anyway, so if you'll if you want to actually use an unprivileged of allow an unprivileged user to actually get around the policy kit access control, then you need to write a rule. Now I have I have some test rules for a user that I created earlier called hello. And it's also policy this also policy rule, but this basically allows you allows this user to manage livevert. So this is actually what such a rule looks like. So I could actually, in theory, implement a simpler rule, similar rule, to allow this unprivileged user to manage the system and services via systemd. So we know the action because we listed it with policy kit action. Where is I? Somewhere. Yeah, here. So this is the action actually. So let's just see if what happens if I actually add a new rule. Polkit. This is the syntax. It's the JavaScript. Add rule function, and then the action and subject. Action, subject, and then a bracket open or brace open, and then start the conditional rule. So I'm just saying, if the action ID action ID equals, and then the address of the action, bus access, and if the subject user. So these are actually, this is object oriented. So the object is subject and the method is user equals hello. Then close this one up. And then the let's just return a pocket result, yes. Now this is then without authentication. And I'm not sure how to do it yet with, for example, first tell them to authenticate and stuff like that. But and then the other one, if not, if fail, then return null, or I guess return a result no, but not sure if that's working either. I know this works, at least I think this works, so I'll just use this. So in theory, if there's no syntax errors, because you need to also be careful about syntax errors, because if there's a syntax error in this rule, then this rule might actually work, but some other rules might fail. So you need to be really careful if you do this, because it's sucks from that perspective. So now let's just try it again. So this is some old stuff. First, so here list all, so I'm able to list, so that virtualization rule that I added earlier, that still works. So now let's just system control and then restart Polypo, which is some proxy thingy. Now failed to issue method call. So now if you look at this error message, then you can actually see that this must be a Dbus related thing, although PolicyKit also uses object oriented thingies. But the method calls and the method returns are actually Dbus related terminology. Dbus basically has a bunch of these. You have method calls, method returns, you have signals, and you have error messages. So from this point of view, I can see that I already went past the PolicyKit access control. So from a PolicyKit perspective, I already have that access. So it was Dbus actually denying access. Let's have a look. Journal control. Journal control, and then since to view only recent messages. Now, like I'm probably 1502, maybe. Just let's look at a message that might resemble what we're dealing with. And actually, I have a syntax error here in this block of code, so I need to fix that first. That's a typo. That shit happens. So it's not pocket, but it's pocket. So let's just first deal with that. And the weird thing is that even though it had an error, the rule was still, I was still allowed to actually get past it. So now we have them again, and then let's check it out again. So now I'll take 4, and the rules loaded okay, I think. Error executing script, poke it, it's not finished. Loading, compiling, reloading rules. Yeah, this seems to be fine now. So but still Dbus is rejecting. So what you see here is actually the stuff that was rejected. So now we actually can allow some stuff from a Dbus perspective. Now I was playing with that as well. And where was I actually? That's probably here as well. So here Yeah, here you have actually the configure the bus configuration files for the various bus names, well-known bus names. So here's that one for a systemd service, or yeah, for the systemd bus name. So let's just open that, and I already tinkered with that a little bit for Dominic, so I can actually use this as an example. So this is a policy bit that applies for Dominic's interaction with the System1 bus name, and to be specific, the manager interface of the System D bus name. So basically, what I'm saying here is, okay, allow Dominic to basically send message calls to the System D1 service, but deny him to actually send the restart unit method to the manager interface of the System1 service. So let's just actually just copy or create another block here for hello. So basically, everything it can do, everything, oops, except restart units. So hello. And let's just yeah, well, okay, this is fine. So now restart unit is still access denied, but I can stop it probably. I should be able to stop it and then start it again. See? And then a status shows that it's inactive but enabled, and that it exited properly. So I can actually start it again and do status again, and now it's running. So this is actually the access controls, basically the policy kit to allow this user to actually send method calls to the system, service, Dbus service, and then Dbus takes over the access control, and then I can actually use Dbus to do access control more fine-grained. And this is just a very coarse example of just denying a single method call. But if you look here, for example, I've been grabbing the systemd source code. If you look in the systemd, let's just less this one. There you can actually see all the methods, all the members that you can actually use, and so basically you can actually prevent. So the language to write these rules is not it's not so nice. So here you have all the members that you can restrict, so to speak. So I could basically, for example, just say, okay, l allow this user only to load a unit, or allow the user to do everything except load a unit. But there's no nice expression language for that. It's just plain XML, which I d but as far as I'm concerned, there's no way to add complex expressions and stuff like that. So if I actually wanted to allow a single permission, for example, do the power off, then I would actually have to deny everything except the power off. So it's going to be a huge policy file. And that sucks. Now, if there is a way to negate, so to say, and actually that might actually be possible, that you that basically tests deny everything and then under there allow only this. I don't think it's gonna work. I think it's probably going to crap out in the top already when it first does a check, but let's just try it. So, for example, let's just say we deny everything. And we allow restart unit. And then so this is these are deny and allow rules. Deny or allow member restart unit. Now, I have a feeling that this is not going to work, which is unfor that which would be unfortunate. Now the status seems to be not constrained. And it actually works. Cool. So status is actually not constrained. That's weird. But now everything except restart unit is denied. So stopping won't work. Starting won't work. What else do we have? Shut down system. I'm not sure if this is going to work. Yeah, I'm not going to try this one because there might actually. That's weird. It's gonna let's find another method call. So status is not constrained, restricted. Damn. Well, I'll just try start. It's a bad example, but I'll just do start, but it's already running, so that sucks. But the access is denied. So yeah, you can only restart the service. That's the point I'm trying to make. Now, we can also actually use SE Linux to even make this more restrictive. Because if you look at lslc, lslc, lib system d system. And then grep polypo. You can see that the polypo unit file has a type identifier that is a private type identifier for polypo unit files. And this is actually useful for the SE Linux access controls because the systemd session and service manager, system manager, basically has a hook into SE Linux. Basically, an extension of SE Linux access control. Basically, it the SE Linux object manager maintains an object which is called the service object. And that service object has a bunch of methods, I guess. We call them access vector permissions, and objects we'll call them security classes or target objects. It's all a couple of terms that are used interchangeably, so to speak. But anyways, so you have the service security class and then a bunch of access vector permissions, and I can actually look those up as well, but I'm not sure if this user is permitted to do that. But it's actually this one here, and then you can actually less and then go to systemd service actually. So we need to look for a service security class and then look up its access vector permissions. this is system, and that's not DBus related, just not system D related, just so you know. Where's this goddamn service access vector? Gotta be somewhere. Oh, here it is. So this is the object that's actually maintained by the systemd object manager, SELinux object manager, and it has a couple of methods or access vector permissions: stop, status, disable, enable, kill, reload, reload, and start. Now we already constrained our user or restricted our user to only reload, but that he can reload or restart any service. And since now we can actually confine that user to only restart the Polypo service using SELinux with the DBus SELinux extension. So that would work. Well, it would be to create actually a policy for that, or create a user for that. So let's just do that. So let's go to let's just cd nano or cd make dir myhello, just a test project there, cd myhello. And then just create a security policy for that. Now there's a couple of things here to keep in mind. First of all, we need this user to only be able to log in via SSH. So let's just create a module, nano myhello te, and then create a policy module with this thingy, call it myhello. And then just call a API that basically has some of the permissions that we need. Restricted, login, user, template. And then I'll just call that myhello. And let's just save and exit this. And then let's just build this. It's not ready yet, but actually let's just also add a user statement in here. So this is actually raw policy language, user my hello underscore you roles my hello r role, and then it's a level I think, which is S0, and then a range I think it's also S0. Hopefully that builds, because I'm doing this from the top of my head and might actually not be the proper syntax. Actually no, but the error is somewhere else. User DOM restricted. Let's just grab our restricted user share SELinux devel include system, and it's actually not the login user template, it's actually just a normal user template. So let's go back and edit this. So this should be this. Now hopefully it doesn't fail on the, yeah, this actually works. So the user declaration was actually fine, seems. So let's just load this into the system. And then my hello. Now, this sets up a new user identity identifier, or identity identifier, role identifier, and type identifier. Now we need to actually associate that identity identifier to the Linux user identity that we want to use. In this case, user hello. And that is something that we actually need to do with the SEManage command, so that we can do that with policy language. SEManage login add and s, and I call it and that's my hello underscore u that we declared in the user statement. This is the identity identifier, and we're going to associate that with the category identifiers of, or the security level identifiers of S0, just simply, and then associate that my hello underscore u as a Linux identity identifier to the hello traditional Linux identity identifier. And this will make that association. This will basically associate my hello underscore u to hello, and then also associate a range to it, an initial range to it, or actually a range to it, a clearance and a and a current, and in this case that's just a single security level. So yeah, that's done. So now in theory, let me just be clear about that. In theory I should be able to log in and get into the right domain. And it says unable to get a valid context for hello. Now that signals to me that something ain't right, and I do already have an idea what that is. Let's just have a look at the login mapping that we just added. Because there's always, not always, but there's usually an extra step that you have to take. So this looks all right. There was actually a my hello underscore u added by with the user statement in that policy module that we created, and the association is actually made. So let's just have a look at the login mappings, or the user mappings. And then see if that my hello is fine. Yeah, so my hello is actually associated to my hello RR. My hello U is actually associated to my hello R. So that looks all good. So why is it barking about the default context? Unable to get valid context for hello. I don't actually know why it can't just be smart enough to see it itself. But I guess we just have to make him a little bit smarter. And actually we might actually be able to specify this. Probably not, but let's just try it. Probably not. I'm just pretty sure that this is not going to work. It's not going to work. So let's just do it the way it's supposed to be done. So I'll just need to create a new default context file, which is located in etc, Azure Linux, targeted, contacts, users, and then I'll need to actually give it the name of the Azure Linux user identity, or the Azure Linux identity identifier name. So sudo, because it corresponds, this file is going to correspond to the user the identity identifier. And then I basically need to add some stuff here. So basically need to tell the PAM Azure Linux, okay, this context belongs to this, and if a user logs in with that login program, then use this context, blah blah blah. So basically what you're getting is my hello t, and then for S0, and then my hello t S0, and then also you need to do it for your login program, in this case SSHD. my hello t, this in theory should work if I'm if I haven't made any typos. So I make typos every once in a while. Oh, actually I don't need to use this one here anymore. I can just do this if all is well. ID. And now I'm running in the proper context here. Now I probably won't be able to use system control now again. I was able to use it last time when I tried it, but since now I changed the Azure Linux policy configuration, I probably won't be able to do it. So let's just try it. System control restart Polypo. And now it actually says, okay, that command isn't even found. So the situation changed terribly. I can't even get to the system control command anymore. So to do this, and even if I could, then there's other issues as well. But let's just start first things first, I guess. And I'll have to look up some of the policy, I guess. I'm going to use the web browser to do that, because my policy IDE is broken, and I don't feel like wrapping this, so I'll just use the web browser. So for example, if I go to the Apache module, actually some other module maybe. Let's just go to the Polypo module, see if Polypo has some systemd support that I can borrow. So yeah, it has some Polypo support. Now basically, in theory, this should be all I need. However, that's in theory, and in practice there's much more to it, I think, suspect. So let's just nano my hello TE. And add this in here and modify it. Basically, there's this interface here that allows me to execute system control. And then there's an interface that allows me to read the unit file. And I suppose I should be able to read it. I suppose to be able to read it. This is actually hello T, then the variable one. And variable one. I'm not sure if I actually need that read file. Let's just try it without first, and then if that doesn't work, add it. And the PS Pro is suspended, so I need to actually or actually I can allow the PS of Polipo, and that's not gonna happen anyways, by the way. But I'm going to add it and comment it out, because it's there for a reason, for some reason. Just don't know why. make it. I have an error at require. Oh right. This one, this rule here, this user statement needs to be all the way below. That's one thing already. Let's see if I still have an error. Unknown type hello T. And that's also right, because it's my hello. But the situation changed, but that's just something you need to keep in mind, that this stuff here, this user statement, needs to be all the way below. And now I have some unknown types. The couple types here that I need to actually import. So I'm just going to import those, and I'm going to do that the raw style. Require. Type Polipo T, and type Polipo unit file T. Okay, save and exit. See if this builds. And this build sudo se module install my hello. But yeah, there's some question with regard to PolicyKit. Why those policy files and user share aren't in the PKLA format, or in the JavaScript format? Anyways, let's see where this gets me. So I should be able to run system control, but that I'm still won't be able to do anything. So here we have an issue. I failed to connect to the dbus, and that's right, because the guest user doesn't have access to the dbus So what I need to do is actually take care of that, and I didn't do that on purpose before, but I'll do it now. So there's this dbus module that provides a dbus role template that we need to call. That should provide us dbus access, the dbus role template. But by default, I'm using the restricted user template, which is not meant to be allowed to access dbus. It's actually for a minimum SSH login user, and normally SSH login users don't need the desktop bus, because the name implies desktop, and SSH users don't have desktops. So they shouldn't. But since times change, actually nowadays even systemd uses it, so yeah, So from that perspective, so the deepest role template, what does it expect? It expects a role prefix, a role, and a domain. Yeah. So the role prefix is my test, or my hello, sorry, my hello. The role is my hello underscore r, and the type is my hello t. And let's see if this builds. So now, in theory, this user should be able to connect to the bus and register with on the bus and stuff like that. But I'm still getting a permission denied here. Let's have a look at audits and see if I can find anything related. I'll search MAVTS recent. No matches. SE module DB to expose hidden alphas. Actually, let's just try the user ABCs first. Nothing. Journal control since 15.36. Getting dark. So I'll just hold on. Okay. No, there's nothing in here either with regards to this stuff. So it must be indeed the module that something is hidden, and something is hidden. That's pretty obvious. Now try that again. Access is denied, and now I'm having some stuffies here. So it's actually this is actually what's up. And this is actually another thingy I need, I guess. Or actually, maybe this was actually the thing that but actually I need to be able to connect to the system bus or system bus client, right? Yeah, this is probably it. So let's just add that as well. It requires a domain. It expects a domain type. Let's see where this gets me. Because the systemd thingy is on the system bus. That service, the systemd service with the manager interface, is on the system bus, and I'm trying to actually send message calls to that interface there. So I need to actually be able to connect to the system buses, I think. But anyways, the AVC denials actually seemed to confirm that, because it was trying to actually traverse dbus within this dbus foreign T, and that's actually basically for the stream connect. I actually needed to stream connect to the system bus. So yeah, that makes sense. Let's try that again. And now Let's see what we have here. Filled. So now we're back to where we were, kind of, from a message point of view. Failed to issue method call, access denied. So why is that? So let's go back. Let's have a look. And now we have a user ABC now. So now actually, this is a DBS Object Manager related ABC now. So here we have actually Milo sending a message to init T, which is actually systemd, and basically it's saying this is actually the method call, the restart unit method call to the manager interface of the systemd service. So we were prevented to actually do that, to send that message. So that's pretty cool stuff. Are they too allowed to translate this? And there's no really good way to translate it anyway, so that is it. And this allowed it to actually send that method call. Now, to be honest, I really not doubt that I need this. I'm just going to do it one by one. I'll need to require some stuff here, by the way. First I need to require type init, which is ifsystemd, and then I also need to require class debus send message. But I'm just trying to not add stuff that I'm not sure that I need it. Let's just try that again. Now it actually works. And the status is not restricted, so I should be able to read the status. Oh, actually, failed to get boot ID, well, that's some other SE Linux issue. But anyways, so if you think about it, it's just crazy. All the access control that's actually now in place. Freaking nuts. This is allowed. Let's see. And this can all, most can be ignored. This can all be ignored. And here it's actually doing some stuff, but can be ignored. It's not strictly needed. So, SE module B. I'm going to just show you what's up. And let's just also actually clean up this module a little bit, because since we don't actually need to be able to read the unit file, then it seems that we don't need to be able to get this stuff, and we don't need this. So it's actually pretty and the weird thing is here that, and actually I'd be interesting to know. Oh, actually, I think I know what's up. It's that macro, this macro that actually. I'm not sure. Anyways, who cares? If it works, it works. So now let's just look at it from point one again, but now we basically used all the access control that's almost available, almost all of it. So let's just exit and log in. ID it. So I'm an unprivileged user and I'm operating in a pretty confined domain, because if I do, for example, top, not allowed, PS aux, not allowed, and a lot of other stuff that's just not allowed. I actually do have quite some access here. But anyways, so from a policy kit perspective, I was actually able to use the I was actually, from a policy kit perspective, by default, I wasn't allowed to do the systemd bus access action. So policy kit by default was actually just denying me access to the systemd bus. Now I added that's when I added that rule here to actually allow me to access to the bus access action. So from a policy kit perspective, at that point I was able to get to the bus, but then the dbus access control kicked in and said, okay, you might be able to access the object but you're not able to send method calls to the manager interface. And so I use the dbus access control to to allow my hello or hello actually to actually send method calls to the systemd servers, except to the manager interface, and then accept restart unit. So I could only, so the user hello can only send method, the restart unit method call to the manager interface. So in other words, I can only restart the unit. I can't stop it, can't start it. I can get status of it, that's just because status is not actually a member, a method call. So although, so I am actually able to get status and restart, but I'm not able to stop. Access is denied. This is actually dbus access denying the access. So as Linux isn't denying the access, policy isn't policy kit isn't denying access. No, this is actually the dbus access control denying me to send the what is it, the stop unit method call. And let's see, stop unit, where is it in the list? Stop unit here. So this one is actually denied. This method call is actually denied. And that's because of the rule that I have here that says, okay, deny all method calls accept restart unit. So this is actually the access control that's blocking that. But then, incorporated as Linux, and I'm just also let's have a look. So for example, Tor. Let's just say I want now to restart Tor. Access is denied. Now this, you still get the same debus message. So you would expect, okay, this is debus, and actually it is debus, but it's not a normal access control. The debus, normal debus and access control. And we can have a look at that, because if I now do SE search of search recent and outer to allow, then you can actually see what's happening here. It's actually SE Linux doing this. So it actually, because here you have it. So from an SE Linux perspective, I am allowed to restart the or actually I'm actually allowed to manage the whole Polypo unit. So from an SE Linux perspective, I'm allowed to stop it, start it, restart it, whatever it. Although from another, from a traditional debus access control, I'm only allowed to restart it, because I'm only allowed to send the restart call method call. But I'm not allowed from SE Linux perspective to do that to other unit files, only to the to the Polypo unit file, and not the Tor unit file. And since I'm try to restart Tor, the access is denied. So with the three components, you have PolicyKit, which actually allows me to not have to use root. So I don't actually have to use root to perform the action of connecting to the system bus, I guess. I'm pretty sure that that's not actually needed anyways, because unprivileged users should often be able to connect. Anyone can connect to the system bus. But I mean, I guess send method calls to the servers or something like that. But anyways, the PK PolicyKit actually allows me so that I don't have to be root to actually do the stuff, manage the services. Then I use SE Linux to actually only to actually tighten down that stuff, only allow it to send restart unit method calls. But that applies to all the unit files, so I can actually say from a debus access control perspective, okay, only make that apply for these unit, for Tor unit files, or for Avaya unit files, or whatever. But for basically only one method call, but it applies to any unit file. And then I use actually SE Linux to say, nah, okay, I want to restrict that even further. So okay, you can only restart, that's fine, but then only the Polypo unit file. So you have these three access controls there, different access controls, which all basically follow up on each other. And I could actually make SE Linux a little bit tighter here as well, because here I'm basically saying manage service perms, but I could actually just say status and start, I guess this should be suffice. So now you have yourself a Polypo admin, at least from the system controls perspective. Because now he still can't, this admin still can't access the Polypo config file, of course, because that's owned by root, and the hello user can't actually manage files owned by root, so that doesn't work. So it's, I'm not saying this is a a super solution, and it actually works. And status also works. And now, actually, from an as a Linux perspective, I can actually block status. So let's just try that, for the sake of. So from a Dbus access control perspective, I can't block status. That sucks. It's just status is everyone is allowed to get status, but from a as a Linux perspective, I can. I think I can at least. I should be able to do it. So now I'm actually blocking the status from a as a Linux perspective. So even though Dbus allows me to do it, as Linux doesn't allow me to do it. So let's see. And now I'm getting that access denied, that issue call again. So that's just pretty fucking crazy. All these access controls, and it's nice because, well, some access controls don't support this, the others don't support that, but if you put them all together, then you're able to get some real nice stuff going on. Although I have to say that SE Linux basically supports it all, pretty much supports it all, except that you can't use SE Linux to allow the what is it, the send message call access to the service. So yeah, if you would only use as Linux, then you would need to be root, because root is actually allowed. Root is actually allowed to send to this destination, and other users aren't. So with SE Linux, that's not something you can manage with SE Linux. I'm a bit confused. Well, I'm not confused. I know what it is. It's actually, root is associated with the admins group, and the admins group is allowed to send. Allow active. Since root is a member of the admin group, I guess, is admin, and he's active, he's allowed to actually send destination. He's allowed to send destination where the destination system, the service. But it's, yeah, it's a little bit complex, without a doubt. Damn. So yeah, that's basically all I'm trying to say. So now I get this unprivileged user that can only restart Polypo. Nothing else. And he's just really restricted. Actually pretty restricted, so to speak. So yeah, that's basically all I wanted to demonstrate.